What happens if Florida legalizes marijuana? Should Miami-Dade County's new sheriff be required to live in Miami-Dade? And why is a trial in Guatemala so important here? Welcome to the South Florida Roundup. I'm your host, Tim Padgett. In the next hour, we'll look at what to expect if Florida voters approve a ballot measure in November to greenlight recreational marijuana use. Spoiler alert, you won't be getting high on the beach. We'll also ask whether residing in Miami-Dade County should be a prerequisite for being elected sheriff of Miami-Dade County because, well, several candidates live in Broward. And we'll discuss a genocide trial underway in Guatemala and why what happened there matters here. All that coming up right after the news. I'm Tim Padgett. Welcome to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. Bienvenidos, bienveni, bemvindo. Recreational marijuana use is now legal in 24 states. In November, voters here will decide whether to make Florida the 25th. Medical marijuana use, of course, is already legal in the Sunshine State, but recreational use is a much bigger deal, especially in a major tourism destination like South Florida. If the ballot measure known as Amendment 3 passes, the cannabis market here stands to light up like a spliff. That's slang for a really big marijuana cigarette. That includes cannabis edibles and even beverages. But the reality is, both the hopes of Florida's weed legalization proponents and the fears of its opponents may be overblown. Even if Amendment 3 gets the necessary 60% yes vote, public marijuana use stands to be significantly restricted. You won't be swinging into the corner convenience store to buy it like beer. Even college campuses, which are usually ganja ground zero, may not see all that much more Mary Jane use. So what is reality and what is hype should the marijuana measure prevail? What do you expect to happen? Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. Joining me now is Michelle Marchante, health reporter at our news partner, the Miami Herald, who's been finding some interesting developments on Florida's hash horizon. Michelle, thanks for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
So remind us, Michelle, what Amendment 3 says specifically. What is it exactly we're voting on in November?
So Amendment 3 is asking if adults 21 and older should be able to legally buy and use marijuana recreationally, so for fun, here in Florida. And we would need at least 60% of voters to say yes to it in order for it to pass.
Mm-hmm. Now, and as you mentioned, like any Florida ballot measure, it needs 60% of the vote to pass. Is that looking likely, especially since medical marijuana use has proven so popular in Florida so far?
So that's what everyone's wondering. And we do have a growing medical marijuana industry here in Florida. There's more than 800,000 people who qualify for a medical marijuana card right now, which is what you need to be able to use marijuana legally here in the state. But the recent polls that have come out from like Florida Atlantic University and USA Today are showing that while there is support for the amendment, we haven't hit that 60% threshold that would be needed.
What do you think might be blunting that, you know, that support, that 60% support anyway that it needs? What might be at play here?
Well, it could be age could be a factor. It could be Florida has an aging population, so it might be people who are less willing to accept marijuana. There could be confusion over what it may or may not do. It really all depends on whether people see the benefits of legalizing it or not.
Yeah, I mean, medical marijuana is one thing. It seems to me, as what I've seen in the rest of the country, is that it's a little easier to demonize, let's say, recreational marijuana use, no?
Right. Yes. Yeah. So it really depends. I mean, like in California, we know it's recreational, but they have restrictions there as well. So when we talk about recreational marijuana, it really depends on the state, but there's restrictions. Like in California, you can't smoke it in public places.
Yeah.
And if it were to pass, we would most likely see restrictions like that also happening here in Florida.
Now, as you point out, there are almost 900,000 medical marijuana cardholders in the state now, and they're driving a $2 billion medical marijuana market in Florida. How many licensed medical marijuana dispensaries do we currently have in the state? Do you know?
Yeah, so the most recent state data for April shows that there's 25 licensed companies that are able to sell medical marijuana here. But when you put all those companies together, they have more than 600 stores across the state. The one that has the most is Trulieve, which was the first one that was fully licensed to sell medical marijuana here in Florida, and is also the one that's been a really big financial backer of Amendment 3.
Right. So given those numbers, should we really be all that surprised then that this recreational pot initiative got enough votes to at least hit the ballot this fall?
I don't think we should be. I mean, it might depend on the voters, but we've been seeing it popping up in states across the country. Now it's here in Florida. We do have the medical marijuana. It was only a matter of time before recreational marijuana made it onto the ballot. Now, will it get enough support from voters is the question, and that's what we're waiting to see.
Now, you also point out that in the meantime, even though recreational marijuana use is still illegal in Florida, we've seen a lot of non-medical cannabis-related products appear here, stuff that contains a lot of the same cannabis-related ingredients like the chemicals THC and CBD, right? I mean, Michelle, explain for us briefly the difference between marijuana per se and products like CBD and cannabidiol, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, that people do have access to right now.
Right. So, yeah, it's a little bit confusing when you start hearing all these terms, but basically THC is the substance that actually makes you high. And CBD is just another ingredient that's found in cannabis. And if you get it by itself, it does not have the properties to make you high. So that's why here in Florida, if you go to like a grocery store or a retailer, you might run into things that say it's like CBD products, like oil, CBD oil, hemp-derived CBD. And that's because right now in the state, adults are allowed to buy CBD products as long as they have 0.3% or less of THC,
right?
Which again is the substance that can actually make you high.
Right, and that chemical strength is really a big factor in this, the way, for example, the proof of an alcohol product would be, right?
Yes, exactly. So how much THC it is how much stronger it is. And we're really seeing, Florida already has restrictions on it, but we're seeing that there's like a law that's looking to put more restriction caps on how much THC products
right.
can have.
And can you give us a rundown of what some of the most popular fare in this regard is, including those beverages we mentioned earlier that I think is kind of a surprise to people?
Yeah, so I think probably CBD oils and topicals, I think most people have seen them at some point. Maybe if you know someone that does medical marijuana, maybe you've seen them using more vapes or edibles. But we're also seeing non-alcoholic hemp-derived THC beers and sodas. And this is growing in popularity in the industry everywhere. And these are just products that have THC, but in low concentrations. But there are some that have higher concentrations, but those are the ones that are typically not allowed here in Florida.
And tell us about something that really jumped out at me in one of your articles, this Benzinga Cannabis Capital Conference that was held last week in Hollywood as a sort of curtain raiser to the kind of marijuana menu we'll be seeing in Florida if Amendment 3 passes.
So in Hollywood, there was this conference where there was entrepreneurs and people from the cannabis industry, and they were talking about potential areas of growth, opportunities, the risks for the industry. And Florida, as you can imagine, was a hot topic. Everyone is talking about, will it pass? What does this mean for our businesses? And, you know, some of them are taking a wait and see approach. These companies, they want to wait to see what Florida does and what rules might happen before they actually come into Florida. Other companies that are already here are looking to expand their presence either way because they expect they're going to see customers. Mm-hmm. And we saw a lot of talk about what this could mean for these non-hemp and THC beverages and just THC beverages in general, if they could become more mainstream here. They're already found in licensed dispensaries
right.
and in certain alcohol retailers, again, depending on how much THC is in them. But there's a big market there that could potentially happen if it becomes legalized.
We have Doug on the line from Miami. He feels that loose enforcement is sort of the situation now. So why not legalize things? Doug, hi, you're on the South Florida Roundup. What have you got to say about this?
Good afternoon. Largely, it's going to happen. It happened before. and it's going to happen again, whether it's legal or not. And that tends to be the things that happens with people who get prohibition.
What specifically is going to happen, Doug?
People are going to continue to consume whatever they want to consume, and they're going to get it through whatever method they need to get it. The question here largely, I think, should slightly be focused on, does this fully decriminalize marijuana so we can decrease the populations of our jails that are full of people that have created minor infractions? That's kind of where I'm headed.
Right.
So if we're going to make it available, we may as well control it and then additionally say, it's all right, stop putting people in jail for it and ruining people's lives.
Right. Well, that's an interesting legal aspect of this whole discussion, I know. Michelle, do you hear that argument a lot too? You're a health reporter, but do you also hear that legal argument a lot when you're delving into this issue with people?
I do, and it's important to remember that this amendment, if it were to pass, it would remove criminal and civil penalties for people who possess and use up to 3 ounces of pot for personal use. But we also have to remember that marijuana as a whole is still illegal on the federal level,
right?
Mm-hmm. So, as to how much it'll decriminalize, it could decriminalize it here in the state to a certain extent. Mm-hmm. But we have to keep in mind that we won't see full decriminalization because of the federal level.
Now, going back to what you were pointing out about, you know, how ripe Florida is as a market for recreational marijuana, we're also seeing medical marijuana operators now. They're worried about the competition, and they're lobbying Tallahassee to curtail certain recreational marijuana products in Florida.
Yeah, so there's a bill that's on the way to the governor that would set stronger THC caps for products. And if that passes, if he signs it, it could potentially ban some CBD products as well as some of these hemp-derived THC beverages. And that would really reduce the amount of people that would actually be able to produce and sell marijuana products.
Right, but if Florida voters pass Amendment 3 in November, would that essentially override then that new law?
So not necessarily. The amendment doesn't prohibit the legislatures from creating laws to regulate the industry here in the state.
Okay, that's an important point.
So now, if it passes, would lawmakers come back? Let's say if this law passes before the vote, would they go back and review it? Maybe, but they would still have the power to be able to regulate how much and where people can use recreational marijuana.
Right. This is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Tim Padgett. I'm talking with the Miami Herald's Michelle Marchante about what to expect should Florida legalize recreational marijuana use this fall. Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. So let's pivot here, Michelle, from the big pot party a lot of people are seeing on the horizon in Florida to, shall we say, the reefer reality that will hit a lot of folks, even if Amendment 3 passes. For starters, I get the sense that recreational marijuana use will be significantly restricted, if not tacitly banned, in public spaces, right? I mean, much more than, say, alcohol.
Most likely. We already have medical marijuana is banned in public. You can't do it in public settings. And just like smoking is banned in malls and in restaurants inside, we have smoking bans. We'll most likely see the legislature set these bans to prohibit smoking marijuana in these public settings. Mm-hmm. Likewise, cities could potentially crack down on it more depending on what the state law says.
Right.
Just like Miami Beach bans smoking on their beaches.
Sure. But you also mention in your work that there's this, quote, social consumption lounge license that we've seen in other states that could be an option for establishments like restaurants here in Florida as well.
Yeah, so in other states that have made recreational marijuana legal, at some point they've allowed certain businesses to apply for a license that would let them have people consume marijuana on their property. Now, nothing like that has been proposed in Florida. So even if this amendment passes, we're not gonna see that. But if it were to pass, it means that at some point down the line, this might happen, similar mm-hmm. to how we have hookah bars here
right.
In South Florida. We
right.
could
so,
potentially see the hospitality industry focus in on that.
Yeah, there could be a lot of legislative flexibility one way or the other then, after even if this passes, is what we're saying.
Correct. Yeah. So it really, once this passes, it really just depends how much the legislatures want to restrict or keep it loose.
Right. And I get just as strong a sense that marijuana users won't be finding pot for sale as easily as they find alcohol. In states where recreational use is now legal, like Tennessee, you can buy weed at gas stations, for example. But tell us where recreational marijuana would and would not be available in Florida if it's legalized here. I mean, are licensed dispensaries only going to be, you know, the option, just like medical marijuana, or will availability be a little broader than that?
So unfortunately, when we come about these laws, it really all depends what the lawmakers will do after the fact, but we can expect that they'll most likely require you to go to a licensed dispensary, because as it is, like CVS and Publix, these types of places cannot sell it
right.
because it's still federally illegal. So that really reduces the footprint of where people would be able to go. Now, we have had like Circle K gas station has been trying to put a dispensary working with Green Thumb Industries, which is a cannabis company, to put a side-by-side store. So you would go to like a Circle K gas station and you would be able to get gas and then go into the store next door to get your products. However, they have not received approval from Florida, and we've been at this for a few years. Now, maybe that will change if this amendment passes. Maybe it'll be easier for dispensaries to pop up. You already see a lot of them, but it really all depends on how much regulation lawmakers will put.
And remind us also, Michelle, college campuses aren't going to be seeing a lot more ganja smoke either if this passes, right?
Correct, because again, since it's still federally illegal, college campuses, since they got federal funds, they won't be able to allow it on their property, but they're also smoke-free campuses. So we have to remember, you can't smoke cigarettes, you can't smoke vapes on these campuses, so you wouldn't be able to smoke marijuana. So any place that probably prohibits smoking, you can imagine will also prohibit marijuana if it passes.
And what about municipalities? This may be more of a speculative question, but we see some cities in Miami-Dade County, like North Miami, for example, where medical marijuana dispensaries are plentiful. We've seen others, though, like Coral Gables, that seem bent on keeping marijuana out. Will local governments be able to dictate whether recreational marijuana can and cannot be sold inside their municipal borders?
So that's a really interesting question. And typically with laws, cities have always been able to crack down and tighten restrictions as long, but they cannot loosen them. So it really depends on how the law will be in the books, but typically they should be able to have power to control maybe like where it is. Maybe it can't be near a school. They probably can put these settings just like they would put for maybe an alcohol retailer. But they could also probably put restrictions on where you can smoke. If you can smoke, you know, at public, if in the park. But again, it all, first off, before they can look at their laws, they have to see what passes at the state level.
At the state level. Well, we'll see in November then. Michelle Marchante is health reporter for the Miami Herald. Michelle, many thanks.
Thank you so much for having me.
Still to come, if you want to be Miami-Dade County Sheriff, should you be required to actually live in Miami-Dade County? This is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. Welcome back to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Tim Padgett. There are a grand total of 17 candidates running in the election this August for the new office of Miami-Dade County Sheriff. This race is a big deal. It will mark the first time Miami-Dade has had an elected sheriff since 1966. So you might take it for granted that all of those 17 hopefuls actually live in Miami-Dade County, but they don't. In fact, two of the candidates considered the front runners reside in next-door Broward County, including one who was just endorsed this week by former President Donald Trump. Florida state law does not forbid sheriffs from living outside the counties they serve. Still, it's reasonable to ask, should Miami-Dade County residents and voters expect that the person they elect to oversee their public security actually be a member of the community that depends on that public security? What do you think? Give us a call at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. Joining me now in the studio is the WLRN investigative reporter whose story raised that very question this week, Danny Rivero. Danny, how are you?
Doing great, Tim.
Let's just start by explaining to folks why Miami-Dade County is even electing a sheriff now after almost 60 years without one. What brought this about?
I love the backstory on this one. Essentially, we used to have a sheriff, but we proved to be incapable of running a well-run sheriff's office, and there was massive corruption scandals in the 1960s.
In Miami?
In Miami.
Gosh.
The sheriff's office was essentially a criminal organization.
Yeah.
Essentially, they were working with the mob at different levels and whatnot. Uh-huh. So in 1966, voters abolished the elected sheriff, and it became essentially a function of the county mayor. And then in 2018, which is like a lifetime ago at this point, voters across the state approved a ballot amendment at the statewide level that made, you know, every county have to elect certain officers, and the sheriff was one of them. Out of that one, Miami-Dade was the only county in the whole state without an elected sheriff. And right now it's finally going into effect and we have this big race.
And just to confirm, current Miami-Dade County Police Director Stephanie Daniels is not a candidate for the new position of sheriff?
That's right. She is not a candidate.
Okay. So let's look at the two sheriff's election front runners here. James Reyes and Rosanna Rosie Cordero Stutz. Tell us about them.
So they are, you know, I wouldn't say that, you know, we haven't had the primary yet, but these are two names that are very much considered top tier candidates here. One's a Republican, Rosie Cordero Stutz, mm-hmm. and also James Reyes, the Democrat.
Democrat, right.
Mm-hmm. So they, through my reporting, I've figured out they don't live in Miami-Dade. They haven't lived in Miami-Dade. Reyes, at least I know since 2008, has lived in Broward County. And Rosanna Cordero Stutz has lived in Broward at least since 1997.
Yeah, and we should point out they both, though, work for Miami-Dade County in law enforcement.
They do. Cordero Stutz has been working for several decades for Miami-Dade County. She's pretty much a lifer at the police department. She has a senior position. But she's been one of those many people that commutes from Broward County down to Miami-Dade. It's the biggest commute in the state, so it's not unusual for that to happen.
Right.
James Reyes worked at the Broward County Sheriff's Office for 22 years, and his life essentially was based in Broward. He came down to Miami-Dade. He was brought on board by Mayor Daniela Levine Cava two mm-hmm. years ago to fix up the jail system, which was under federal supervision, and you know, he played a big role in getting us out of that, and now he's the chief of public safety. He's kind of overseeing the fire rescue department, the police department, and the corrections, so he's a very senior member of all these offices in Miami-Dade County, but he remains a Broward County resident,
and he is endorsed by Miami-Dade County Mayor Daniela Levine Cava.
That's right. I mean, he came into the race pretty late, James Reyes. Mm-hmm. The mayor was originally backing Freddy Ramirez, who was the longtime police director, strong ally of the mayor. He dropped out of the race
because of personal difficulties.
He attempted suicide.
Exactly.
Very tragically dropped out of the race. And then James came in and the mayor has now endorsed him.
And we should also mention at the same time, Rosie Cordero Stutz was just endorsed this week by former President Donald Trump, after she was endorsed by Republican Miami Congressman Carlos Jimenez, the former mayor of Miami-Dade County, whose family is playing a big role in her campaign, correct?
That's right. The Trump endorsement seemed like it came kind of out of nowhere, but when you start connecting the dots, it doesn't quite seem to be out of nowhere. You know, Cordero Stutz did get Congressman Jimenez's endorsement some time ago. You know, but her campaign manager, Tanya Cruz Jimenez, is former mayor, current congressman Jimenez's daughter-in-law.
Yeah.
So she's running his campaign. And Jimenez has been increasingly close with Donald Trump.
Yep.
And so, you know, that certainly elevates her stature among Republican voters. And we're going to have, you know, a Republican and a Democratic primary in this. This is not nonpartisan election.
If one candidate is being endorsed by Donald Trump and another candidate is endorsed by Mayor Levine Cava, I would say that makes those two candidates pretty significant in this race.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, one thing I'll add is, and, you know, I've talked to so many of these candidates at this point and so many people that are watching this race. The endorsement from Trump and former Mayor Jimenez seems like a big deal, but I've been told that doesn't necessarily mean rank and file people in the department are necessarily supporting. Uh-huh. Jimenez has a very bad reputation among many law enforcement officials because the police union had a huge labor dispute,
mm-hmm.
that Jimenez was, you know, battling them on for years, and a lot of them like point to that and say like he's not our guy.
That's an interesting point. But Reyes and Cordero Stutz are not the only candidates residing outside it. We have a third candidate, John Barrow, also lives in Broward. Correct. Tell us about him.
Right. John Barrow is you know, he was born and raised in you know, what's now Miami Gardens. He's a major, and he's a Democratic candidate, and you know, this was such an interesting story to report, because I started when I realized James Reyes was living in Broward County at first, and then I was calling other candidates for another story I was working on about their, you know, everyone's disciplinary histories, use of force incidents, etc. And then I just started tacking this on to something like, you know, have you heard there's at least another candidate that's living in Broward? And then I started getting some of the other candidates saying, oh, yeah, so-and-so lives in another county, too.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is just common knowledge among the candidates. And this was not publicly known, to be honest.
And we should remind folks that technically a Florida county sheriff is not legally required to live in the county they're serving, but some counties in Florida do have local laws that require it. Miami-Dade just happens to be one that does not. But does the residence reality you discovered in your reporting about these Miami-Dade sheriff's candidates seem to raise flags for people?
It does, but I want to finish the question from before. So I was asking all these candidates, like, you know, do you know of, you know, how do you feel about someone living in another county or whatnot? And John Barrow, the Democrat, I mean, he just told me, he said, well, I live in Broward.
Yeah.
You know, and.
But he also pointed out that my barber lives in Dade, my, you know, et cetera.
Right.
It's like a lot of his life is in Miami-Dade. He just happened to reside in Broward.
This was a pretty difficult story to report. Essentially, different offices in Broward County made errors that allowed me to even report it, because you're not supposed to be able to find the address of police officers.
Exactly.
And they kind of messed up, uh-huh. because I was able to find and document, okay, you know, at least these two candidates mm-hmm. live in Broward. And then John Barrow told me, well, I live in Broward too. So I tacked him onto the list.
Right. So again, let's go back to what are the flags that this seems to raise for people, though?
You know, we've already started to see some candidates using this in their messaging. I mean, just after my reporting came out, Joe Sanchez, who is, you know, the Republican who's raised the most money in this, he was a former City of Miami commissioner. He has started to use this as part of his messaging, saying, we need someone who's from Miami-Dade County, who mm-hmm. lives here and calls this their community.
Yeah. You
know, like the point is, his kids go to school here. He votes in local elections. You know, the people who live in Broward County, they couldn't vote for the past mayors.
Right.
They can't vote for themselves, in fact.
Right. So this looks to become a campaign issue, especially for the other 14 sheriff candidates who do live in Miami-Dade County.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, it's legal, but it goes to something of a, you know, a turf war between Miami-Dade and Broward County at some points. Like, why would you go north of county line?
Mm-hmm.
Why would you do that if you call Miami-Dade home?
Well, let's get to that. This is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Tim Padgett. I'm talking with WLRN's Danny Rivero about whether Miami-Dade County sheriff candidates should actually reside in Miami-Dade County. Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. So, Danny, first, in their own defense, what did Reyes, Cordero, Stutz, and Barrow tell you about their residence status vis-a-vis their run for Miami-Dade Sheriff? Barrow, for example, has, you know, raised the housing affordability issue in the article you wrote, how unaffordable housing can be in Miami-Dade County, though it would seem, given what you learned about his salary, that he could afford to live here, no?
Yeah, I mean, all of the candidates that we're talking about here that live in another county, they have six-figure salaries. They're not low-wage police officers. Mm-hmm. And you know, Barrow did say when he was looking to buy a house in 2015, he couldn't find anywhere affordable, mm-hmm. and that's what brought him north of county line. James Reyes, I talked to at length about this, and you know, essentially he was living and working in Broward County, and he bought a house there, and he told me in his defense, he said, "I'm about as south in Miramar as you can possibly be without being in Dade County."
Right.
But so he basically said, like, "I can see Miami-Dade County from my back porch."
Right.
So, like, don't hold it against me too much.
But did any of them say, well, look, if I do get elected Miami-Dade County Sheriff, I will make a point of moving back into Miami-Dade County?
Yes. James Reyes and John Barrow did both tell me that if they win, they do intend to move back down to Miami-Dade. And Cordero Stutz actually was not able to get in touch with her in her campaign for this.
Okay.
So I didn't. Unfortunately, I didn't get anything.
But let's take a step back, though, and perhaps make what might be an important distinction here. I think a lot of people, voters, might be more understanding if these candidates were applying for a job, say, the way someone applies for Miami-Dade schools superintendent. If the applicant were living in Broward or even across the country in California, it wouldn't matter as much in that context, it seems to me. But when that person is up for election by the county's voters, seems to be a different matter, does it not?
Yeah, I mean, you can't win a county commission seat or a city commission seat or county mayor if you don't live where you're running. But this is just a quirk of Florida law, and you know, we don't have a local law about this. There's two counties in Florida that require sheriffs live in the county that they serve. We are not one of them in Miami-Dade County.
Yeah.
You know, in 2 years ago in Duval County, they have one of these local ordinances, and reporters found out that the sheriff had moved to neighboring Nassau County, and boom, he was gone. He violated his...
Well, because he was essentially violating the law.
Yeah, he was violating his oath of office, uh-huh. and he vacated it.
Right.
But we don't have it.
Right. But there's a non-legal, non-technical
right.
facet to this that I think sort of hits the gut of a voter, no?
That is my understanding. And certainly some of the candidates told me that. It's like, if you want to be the elected sheriff here, you need to have skin in the game. Mm-hmm. And some of the candidates I talked to said, if you live north of county line, you don't have skin in the game. One of the candidates told me this is a job for you. And he mm-hmm. said, my thoughts and feelings on Miami-Dade County are sincere because I live here.
Yeah.
This is not a job. My family's here.
Well, do you get the sense then that for future Miami-Dade sheriff's elections, the county might pass a law like those other two to require that candidates reside in Miami-Dade?
You know, one of the Republican candidates, Orlando Lopez, he did tell me, I mean, he thinks the county should change the county charter and make that a requirement like some other counties in Florida have done. So, I mean, we'll have to see, I guess.
And finally, Danny, just in the 30 seconds we have left, we've been talking about Miami-Dade sheriff's candidates who are living in Broward County, but you mentioned to me that one candidate might actually reside even farther away in Palm Beach County.
That is right. And you know, I've had a few people tell me it. You know, I can't say too much because I don't have it fully confirmed, but the reality is they could be living anywhere
sure.
in the state. They could be living in Putnam County. They could be living anywhere run for sheriff.
We'll see if it makes a difference in the voters' minds. Danny Rivero is a WLRN investigative reporter. Danny, thanks as always.
Thanks for having me, Tim.
Still to come, why a genocide trial in Guatemala matters here. This is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. Welcome back to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Tim Padgett. Guatemala's civil war, which lasted 36 years and ended in 1996, left 200,000 people dead or disappeared. More than 80% of those victims were rural indigenous Maya. They were often massacred by the military and its paramilitary civil patrols because they were suspected of being leftist guerrillas or guerrilla sympathizers. The most horrific period of that slaughter was the early 1980s, led by Army General Benedicto Lucas Garcia, then brother of then Guatemalan President Romeo Lucas Garcia. Benedicto Lucas Garcia is now 91, but he is now on trial in Guatemala for committing genocide against those Maya in that period. This is historic because it's arguably the first time genocide is being alleged and prosecuted in the Western Hemisphere, in the same way it has, for example, in Europe with the Holocaust or in Africa in the case of Rwanda. And it matters here because many of the survivors of the Guatemalan terror fled to South Florida, and they have a deeply personal stake in seeing that it never happens again. Are you aware of the genocide trial in Guatemala? Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. Joining me now to discuss the Guatemalan genocide trial is Father Franco Laughlin, the Roman Catholic priest who directs the Guatemalan Maya Center in Lake Worth Beach and saw the plight of those Maya communities up close during the Civil War. Father O'Loughlin, thanks for being with us. Father, as I was telling people, reminding them that we, of course, can't forget that Guatemala's conflict wasn't the only 20th century tragedy in Latin America and the Caribbean that saw large-scale massacres and disappearances. There was, as I mentioned, the dirty war in Argentina, or for that matter, the civil war next door in El Salvador. These were all extremely dark human rights episodes in the region's history. But why, Father, does what happened in Guatemala in the 1980s rise to the level of genocide, the same sort of attempt to exterminate an entire people that, as I mentioned, can be compared to horrors like the Holocaust in Rwanda?
We came to, the whole war came to Guatemala with a model in Southeast Asia for setting up villages in which there was a psychological stripping of the people of their language, of their culture, even of their clothing, and so on. It was, and some of the people who did it called it the Palestining of Guatemala. It was a massive psychological thing, and it was engineered by getting ambitious young officers and coloring them through the School of the Americas so that they could
see. Right, the School of the Americas being the military academy in the United States back in those days, right, where a lot of Latin American military officers were trained.
And where officers for all these other problem places you mentioned were prepared, yeah.
Right. But you mentioned, though, I mean, that the distinction here being that you're not just the attempt here was not just to, defeat leftist guerrillas by going after the Maya in Guatemala. The distinction here is that they were trying to eradicate a culture which they saw as being sort of anti, against the Guatemalan establishment, I would say. Right.
In a country where 50% or more of the people were Mayan, and they saw the rest of the country as Ladinos, people hostile to them. It was that division. Right. Now, how we managed to make that part of the global war between East and West, I think you can thank personal ambition for that.
Now, the trial underway now in Guatemala is focused, as I mentioned, on former Army General Benedicto Lucas Garcia, who was accused of engineering genocide against the country's indigenous Maya population. He insists he is innocent, that all he was doing was prosecuting Guatemala's war against leftist guerrillas, and that nothing he did in those days was meant to exterminate the Maya as a people. But what would you say, Father, is the strongest evidence against Benedicto Lucas Garcia?
Well, his brother was the president, and it was all part of the same. They were selling themselves and their services to the Reaganites.
Meaning the Ronald Reagan administration in the United States that was in power in the United States in the early 1980s.
When Jimmy Carter was president, and he saw the extent of the attack on the Mayan people, he cut off armaments, he cut off supplies to Guatemala. He joined all the European governments that were denouncing the mayhem in Guatemala.
Right. But Father, let's go back to Benedicto Lucas Garcia himself. What is it about his specific actions in Guatemala in the early 1980s that is what you would call strong evidence against him for genocide?
You have been to Guatemala and you are aware of the disinterment of mass graves.
Exactly.
Which, to discover the evidences that entire villages were exterminated without any political reason that could possibly justify it.
Yeah.
Without any evidence that these people were, as they say, communists, or that they were sympathetic with any uprising.
As I mentioned at the outset, you spent considerable time with the Maya in Guatemala during that time. Did they often tell you, Father, in those days that they felt Guatemala's military and political elite weren't just out to punish them for supposedly aiding leftist guerrillas, but were out, as I said before, to eliminate them as a people?
Precisely that. You might not wear the clothing of your village and of your people. You might not speak the language of your village and your people. You might not carry on the customs of your village. All Mayan identity was perceived as hostile to the crowd who were in government.
Right. And in the military.
The military were the government at that stage.
Right. And yeah. I, and for example, I mean, one Maya that I've talked to in regards to this trial pointed out that he heard, for example, Benedicto Lucas Garcia himself, during a visit to a village there, proclaim that he wanted the military to make all the women in these villages, for example, take off their Maya garb and put on, quote, more Western clothes. And that in itself was a way of eradicating the Maya culture. And Father, this would have followed a sort of national historical pattern, though, right? The attempted genocide of Guatemala's Maya dates back to Pedro de Alvarado, the first Spanish conquistador who arrived there in the 1500s, no?
Well, I think it's important, though, to stay with the modern era. Mm-hmm. You know, the outrages and the sins of the Spanish are what they are.
Yeah.
But...
No, good point. This is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Tim Padgett. I'm speaking with Father Franco Laughlin of the Guatemalan Maya Center in Lake Worth Beach about the genocide trial underway in Guatemala. Call us at 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. So this brings us, Father, to the decades-long effort to build a genocide case against Army General Benedicto Lucas Garcia, which actually began, as you mentioned before the Civil War was even over, right, with the exhumations of these graves in these villages, these massive common graves of these massacre victims. Why in the end do you think Guatemalan prosecutors decided to accept the case and bring it to trial now?
Oh, they have accepted it very reluctantly. Mm-hmm. It has had to be forced down their throats. And the judiciary in Guatemala is not today reconciled to hearing these cases.
Yeah.
But the people in Guatemala have, I don't know where they found it, but they have found this new spirit. You saw that they just recently astonished everybody by giving themselves a new president.
Right. Right. A more liberal president. Bernardo Arevalo. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we hardly know what to make of him. He is so much out of line with everything that has passed in Guatemala. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is an astonishing defeat of what Guatemalans call the coalition of the corrupt.
Right, el pacto de los corruptos, right. But Arevalo's presidency has created a better atmosphere, let's say, for the prosecution of this trial.
Oh, well, if he can hold his seat, if the country can really be strong enough to keep him.
And a lot of the testimony and evidence that helped build that genocide case came from Guatemalan Maya, who now live here in South Florida, many of whom are served these days by the Guatemalan Center you direct in Lake Worth Beach, right?
How did I get into this? At the very beginning of the 80s, I was working with the migrant farm workers, trying to show them how to defend one another. And one day, they organized people came and said that seven men and a woman had just been picked up on the street by the border patrol, nobody knew who they were. What was different about them? They walked in single file. They were down from the highlands. Mm-hmm. They only knew to walk in single file.
Right.
And they were the first of these families. We had border, our community had crew buses broadcasting down on the border, come to Indian Town, where there is housing, work, and a cura who will help you with the migra.
Right. Cura being a priest.
Yeah.
Right. And as you mentioned, a lot of them live here now because they were driven out of Guatemala by the Civil War, or because they were being persecuted by the military there even after the war. So how important do they see this genocide trial underway now in terms of making Guatemala a place where the Maya can live safely and peacefully again, and to make sure what happened a generation ago never happens again?
Well, the ones who've been here all those years are scarcely aware. You know, you hate to say this, but I still don't think that the Guatemalan Maya understood what hit them.
Right.
But now we have, in some areas, we have people who have educated themselves.
Right.
The Ixil have wonderful leadership.
Right. Father for time, I'm sorry, we're going to have to end it here, but I should also mention that the Guatemala Maya Center is also involved in another Latin America-related human rights trial coming up in Colombia soon. Father Frank O'Loughlin directs the Guatemala Maya Center in Lake Worth Beach. Father Frank, thanks as always. And I should also mention that my WLRN report on the South Florida Maya involvement in the Guatemalan genocide trial will air next week.
Okay, we'll do more with the Ixchel.
Okay. Good. Take care.
Thank you.
Finally on the roundup, there's a power play going on between the mayors of Fort Lauderdale and Tampa, but it's about hockey, not politics. As you may know, the Florida Panthers, whose home is Broward County, and the Tampa Bay Lightning are squaring off in the first round of the National Hockey League playoffs, so Fort Lauderdale Mayor Dean Trantalis and Tampa Mayor Jane Castro have made a bet. Whoever's team loses has to light up their city in the winning team's color. Mayor Trantalis had this to say in a video posted to X.
Our Panthers versus your Lightning. These teams are sparking a renaissance, and I think we can both agree Florida is dominating the hockey scene between our four combined Stanley Cup final visits. So, Mayor Castor, up for a friendly bet?
Mayor Castro's reply was a little grittier.
We are going to light our city up in blue, and it's going to stay that way because the Bolts are going to kick some butt.
Right now, though, it's the Panthers who are kicking Bolt butt. Last night, they beat the Lightning again to take a 3-0 lead in the best-of-seven series. The Lightning can avoid getting swept if they come back and beat the Panthers in Game 4 tomorrow at Tampa's Amalie Arena, starting at 5 p.m. That'll do it for the South Florida Roundup. It's produced by Helen Acevedo with help from Polly Landis. Katie Munoz is our director of original live programming. Mateo Sanchez is digital editor. Sergio Bustos is WLRN's vice president of news. The vice president of radio and the show's technical supervisor is Peter J. Mertz. Richard Ives answers the phones. I'm Tim Padgett. Have a great weekend and thanks for listening. Gracias. Merci. Obrigado.
WLRN.